Thank you. greet this morning. To those of you who are watching online, we say welcome to you as well. It is a great day, a wonderful day to be in God's house, to worship Him, to fellowship together. Just a couple of quick announcements as we begin our time of worship this morning. This is Promotion Sunday for the children. So in Sunday school, if we have children, they're going to be promoting to the next grade level. A new teacher, if you're an adult, you just go right back to the same class you're going to. If you've not been going to Sunday school, find a class. You can promote yourself to any class you want to go to.
Amen.
We would love to have you. Also, this Wednesday, for our children and teenagers, begins our summer ministry at Limestone Park. It's Splash for Jesus for children, and we just call it Limestone for teenagers. That event is free. It's every Wednesday night in the summer. There's food, there's swimming, there's Bible study. All age-appropriate activities, no cost. You don't have to be a member of Limestone Park. Come and join us. Peggy, what time does it start for the children?
Yes, it starts at 5:30.
So 5:30 for youth and children it begins.
And it's over at
7
for children.
And it's over at 7 for children, 8 o'clock for teenagers, because they like to stay up late. So it's for the teenagers. But it's a wonderful ministry. So many folks in the area, not just part of our church, but multiple churches, plug into that ministry. And we're in store for a fun summer at Limestone Park. So join us this Wednesday. Would you join me in prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for this day. Father, we are grateful for the air that you put in our lungs at this very moment. We thank you for the freedom that we have to gather and fellowship and worship. Lord, there are many things vying for our attention, the attention of our hearts and our minds this morning. And I pray that you would just move those away from our thoughts, from our hearts. Father, help us to focus on you. Help us to be present in this place so that we can experience your presence here today. Father, we pray that our worship would honor you today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Mill Creek. Welcome to Lakeland Online. You know, we're singing this morning about worship. And worship isn't about us. It's about God. So as you sing this morning, lift your praises to Him. It doesn't matter what you sing. It's okay. Just make a joyful noise.
Now is the time to
wish y'all could hear y'all. If we have preschoolers who would like to go out, Ms. Sharon, Ms. Baker, and Junior, everyone else take a few minutes and say hello.
Those of you here, as well as those joining us online, we're excited. you are part of our worship here at Mill Creek this morning on this first Sunday in June. Good golly. Seems like January was just last week. We are going to enter into our time of prayer right now. Let me just remind you that we will be participating in this Lord's Supper in a few moments. And so use this time as an opportunity to seek the Lord. And what areas in your life do you need to get right with Him before coming to this meal? Paul wrote about coming to this meal in an inappropriate fashion in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we want to be sure that as we participate in it, that our hearts and our minds are in the right place. So again, during this time of prayer, let me just invite you to be seeking the Lord in those areas. Our person of prayer for this week is Mary Painter right there. Hey, wave, Mary. Mary's one of our greeters. So she, Mary, do you shake hands back there? Yeah. After each service, I go to the bathroom to wash the Baptist off. But as a greeter back there, man, she's just great back there, and we appreciate Mary. Be praying for her this week. Also, you know, as I look at our prayer list can be broken down. Our request for members can almost be broken down by those who are recovering from recent procedures or have an upcoming procedure, as well as those who have ongoing health challenges. And so often, I know in my own life, especially when I stand up here, I mention those who have things coming up or just had things go on, but neglect those who have ongoing challenges like Alexis Andrews and Susan Ditzler, Helen Hodges, Teresa and Frank Garrett, and Jerry Fink, Catherine Simpson, Ann Huffman, Betty Swanson. All of those need our continued prayer. So remember them, especially in this coming week, as well as others who are listed here on our sheet. This is not political. Exclamation point. This is not political. We need to pray for our nation like we have never prayed before. This handbasket is a downward spiral to hell on such a fast trajectory right now. There's a lot going on in the world around us. There's a whole lot going on in this nation. I don't care where you fall. So I have one of the most wonderful compliments I've had from a church member in a long time this week. We were having a conversation. They said, "I don't know whether you're Democrat or Republican." I said, "That's because my allegiance is to a person, not a party." So I don't care what side of the aisle you're on. This nation needs prayer. So remember that this week. Let's go to the Father this morning. God, we come before you. Father, thanking you for our church family. Whether they're here in person or online, Lord, they're family. Father, we're so grateful for them. Lord, we thank you for Mary Painter and for the way she serves you here in this body by being a welcoming and engaging face to those who come in these doors. Pray your blessings on her this week. Father, for those on a prayer list, not just who have gone through recent procedures or have them coming up, for those who have ongoing challenges that they deal with on a daily basis. Chronic pain. Always having tests run to make sure that the cancer's not growing. Eye challenges and all kinds of other things, Lord. We lift them up to you and pray that you would encourage them this week as we remember them in our prayers. Father, for our nation right now, Lord, your word calls us to pray for our leaders. Putting our personal thoughts aside, Lord, we lift up our leaders to you. We pray, Father, that wherever they are or not in a faith relationship with you, I pray your spirit would just grab them, Lord. Father, speak to them and use them in ways that bring honor and glory to you. Father, for this meal as we prepare to share it and receive it with one another, Lord, speak to our hearts and open up those areas in our life that we need to give over to you. Maybe even thoughts from this past week, Lord, that we need to give over to you. Before we proclaim Jesus as Lord and accept this meal. So, Father, speak boldly to us. Lord, as we give our tithes and offerings back to you, Lord, we are so grateful for the many ways in which you bless us. Lord, everything we have is a gift from you to begin with. So, Father, we return that to you now out of gratitude and out of an expression of our love for you. Use and bless these gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, you'll be saved. This morning, if you confess Christ as Lord and Savior, if you claim Him as your Redeemer, this morning we invite you to participate in this meal with us. You don't have to be a member at Mill Creek, just a member of the family of God. Scripture says that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, He gathered with His disciples in an upper room. The elements that were present that night at the meal were these. They were bread and wine. Scripture says Jesus took the bread. He blessed and gave thanks for it. Would you pray with us?
Truly remember the sacrifice on the cross.
Having blessed it, he shared it with his disciples. And we invite you to share it with one another. What is your confession of faith this morning, church?
Jesus is Lord.
As often as you eat this bread, eat it in remembrance of him. Also on the table that night was a cup of wine. Scripture lets us know that in like fashion, Jesus took and blessed and gave thanks for it as well. Again, would you pray with us? After blessing it, he shared it with his disciples. And again, we invite you to do the same. Thank you. Church, what is your confession of faith this morning? Scripture says, as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim him until his return. Do this in remembrance of him. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, whom we can claim as Lord and Savior. Lord, help that to be our battle cry. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, take your Bibles and open them up to Philippians chapter 4 this morning. We're going to be looking at a brief passage here. I know one verse is listed because that's what I gave Sandra earlier in the week. And the more I worked on, the more I prayed over this message, the more I thought, well, we just need to add a couple others to get the full effect here this morning. I want you to go back to your inner child. For our children, that's not going to be difficult. Some of you are going to have to step back a couple of years. But I want you to go back to your inner child, and I want you to imagine with me this morning, okay? We're going to use our mind to imagine. Imagine that there is a countertop right here, and on this countertop is a blender. And in this blender, I'm going to take some of our, mine and Debbie's, homemade vanilla ice cream. Because I know what ingredients are in that bad boy. And they are all pure. And so I'm going to put a few scoops of that into the blender. I'm going to take some milk over here, and I'm going to add that. And then right here is some of my mom's, now, because I made it, my mom's recipe, homemade hot fudge syrup. Again, I'm using it because I know the ingredients, and I know they're pure. And so I'm going to add some of that homemade hot fudge. It's not hot right now because it'd be melting my ice cream. I'm going to put a little more. I'm going to put the lid on and whatever your blender does, I don't know. Push stop, and I'm going to pour into my cup a what? What kind of milkshake? Not just a chocolate milkshake, y'all. It is an amazingly pure, tasty, nothing better chocolate milkshake. Y'all don't know this, Debbie and I recently moved, and would anybody like some of my milkshake? Wait a minute. Because I know we are all on a health conscious kick right now. We need our fish oil. And so I'm just going to add a sardine into this. Don't you me. It's not the whole can. It's a sardine. And sardines are little, in case you have not noticed. A little sardine. And we need some greens. Well, there's a cow patty, and cows eat greens. So just take a little pinch of that and put it in. A little dab will do you, is what they used to say. Little cow manure in there, just a little. Don't want to ruin it. We need it to go down. So I'm going to pour a couple tablespoons of castor oil in there. Some of y'all just went way back to your inner childhood. That ought to do it. And now I'm going to... How many still want some of this milkshake? The sardine is still pure. The pinch of manure is as pure as it gets. Castor oil, I don't even know where that stuff comes from. And it's just a little of each. But you weren't as excited any longer about this here milkshake. Our lives are a lot like this blender. What we put into our mind, what we put into our heart mixes together and affects what comes out, especially in the way that we live. Sometimes we fill our minds with things like worship, Bible study, Christian podcasts or Christian music, faith-based television or movies, and what comes out is what we put in. It shows in our actions, in our dealings, our relationships, our speech. It shows in how we live. But sometimes we add into this blender just a little speech that's unbecoming. I mean, it's not the F-bomb. I'm just dropping little things like concrete barriers that hold the water back. Some of y'all will get that later. I'm not going to say it. Or that manure in another form. We just not a lot of inappropriate language, just a little bit. Or we had just a little pornography, not the hard stuff, just the soft core stuff. We had a little bit of movies or television or music that is not appropriate into our lives. Adding even a little of these things begins to show in the way that we live, in the way that we talk, and in how we treat others. Because what we put into our blender not only affects us, it affects those who come in contact with us. It affects what others think about us, how they view us, and what they see in us. Just a little milk, ice cream, and homemade chocolate syrup was, good. But as soon as we started to add just a little of the other stuff, all of a sudden it wasn't as desirable. It became gross and nasty and detestable. You should have seen some of your faces. There's a saying. I first heard this on the golf course. A couple years ago. A friend and I were playing. We had gotten paired up with another twosome, and so we're playing along and we're golfing. And one of these guys, I mean, he was a rugged, handsome man. He could have been an Under Armour model, you know? And I mean, I'm just sitting here going, this is a man's man right here. More expletives came out than normal words. And so finally, I always love it when I get paired up. I've shared this before, because finally about hole 4 or 5 or whatever, they'll often go, so what do you do for a living? Well, Under Armour man, I'm a pastor. Oh, yeah. You know, I mean, I'm sure you've noticed that I might cuss a little bit, but man, I love Jesus. Try going to your spouse and saying, I might date around a little bit, but I love Jesus. And see how that goes over. If you've got to add, but I love Jesus on the backside, you're trying to justify your behavior. Because what you put in is what comes out. Just a little is a huge lie from Satan, who's waging war for control of your minds and your hearts. And when we give in to just a little of whatever he's peddling, it affects what comes out in our life and what people experience, and what they see can be just as gross and detestable as what went into that milkshake. Follow along in Philippians chapter 4, beginning in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice! Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Here's our focal passage for today, verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Paul's writing this letter to the church at Philippi to encourage them to stand firm in the face of conflicts in the world around them. this was on the date to be preached today long before any events from this past week. Stand firm in the face of persecution. Stand firm in all of the stuff happening around you. And one of the ways that he does this is found in these verses when he tells the church at Philippi to rejoice in the Lord, even when you're experiencing pushback because you live different from the world that you're living in. Rejoice. It's so important. He said it again. Rejoice. He tells them that how they live and how they deal with things will be evident to everyone around them. Let your gentleness be evident to all, Paul said. And that happens as we guard our minds and our hearts. Our minds are a beautifully created part of our body. Our mind gives us the capability to function, to think, to perform the actions and skills that we possess and oftentimes do without ever thinking about it. But our minds are also a battleground. It is a place where Satan tries to gain control by firing missiles and ammunition at you all day long. It comes in the form of negative thoughts and information in an attempt to distract you. And well, Jesus said to destroy you. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, Jesus said. And so that's what these things from Satan are meant to do to you. Not just distract, but to kill and destroy. The things we allow into our minds have a direct effect on what we do and what others experience in us. Every day we're bombarded with messages that have an effect on us. The internet, social media, television, music, movies, all have an effect on our values and our views concerning what is normal life and behavior. Sadly, and I don't know what our teenagers or children today are going to compare to decades from now, but when I look back over the decades in my life, we have become so tolerant of things that used to be deemed inappropriate. They were inappropriate to the world, not just to Christians. But we have become desensitized and tolerant. I hate that word, tolerant, to all that's going on around us. The messages we continue to put into our minds influence us. They influence our heart. They influence our attitudes and beliefs that we have about life. They influence what we say and how we say it. In Matthew 12:34, we read, out of the overflow of our heart, our mouth speaks. So what we put into this blender of ours influences our actions, our attitudes, the choices that we make. It's that age-old adage, garbage in, garbage in, garbage out. So when it comes to your mind, what are you allowing into it? I want us to think about three things in relationship to our hearts and our minds this morning. Paul mentions them here when he says, the first thing, we need to guard our heart and mind. Proverbs 4:23-27 tells us, above all else, before anything else, the most important thing, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths of your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. In other words, if we store up good things in our hearts, our words and our actions will in turn be good. If we guard the ingredients that go into our mind, we will have better control over what comes out in our everyday life. So the first step to guarding our hearts and minds begins with evaluating the ingredients that we're putting into them. Well, how do we do that? Well, we just begin to ask questions of ourselves. Take an inventory of your life. What am I allowing into my mind? What do I dwell on? What messages are these things feeding me? Do my thoughts and my attitudes honor Christ? How do these things affect the way that I think or the way that I live? If you want to answer that one, ask those who you live with. Would I be comfortable watching this or listening to this or posting this if Jesus were sitting right here beside me? Hello. We are called to guard our hearts and minds. The next thing we need to do is fill our mind. Whenever there's a void, there's a vacuum that pulls things in. But we have to take responsibility for what we allow into our minds. That's where Philippians 4:8 comes into play. It gives us a great recipe for what to put in there. Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. I have to believe that Paul was using his Jewish upbringing at this moment. He was referring back to Psalm 19, 7 through 9, when he wrote this. Here's what the psalmist wrote. Look how closely they match up. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. Boy, doesn't that match up well with Philippians 4:8? When we fill our mind with what God says, it doesn't leave room to put in what the world says. When we fill our minds with the things of God, there's no room for the things of this world. But too many people today are listening to and filling their mind with garbage off the internet. CNN, Fox, talk show personalities, and everything else, and they're not leaving any room for what God says. They're putting the wrong ingredients in, and there's no room for the things that God says ought to be in there. According to research I read from one mental health institution, a few years, and I have a hard time with this, so it's okay for y'all to have a hard time with it. I thought, it says the average, so I'm going to go with the average. A few years ago, the average time viewing screens, computer screen, TV screen, iPad, iPhone, whatever. The average screen time for adults in the United States was about 11 hours per day. Now, for those of you who work in front of a computer, there's 8 of them, okay? This is the one that I went, there's no way. During the pandemic, that increased to 19 hours per day. On average. And they said close to 30% of adults that they surveyed classify their online activity in the category of almost constantly. The study found that people who spend 6 hours or more per day watching screens had a higher risk for depression. And that limiting social media use to 30 minutes per day led to a significant improvement in personal well-being. Duh. Guard your mind, Paul says, with this recipe for a beautiful mind. And then he says to fill it with these things, whatever is true. You're probably not going to find that on the screen. Well, if it's in the news, or if it's in social media, it must be true. I'm going to leave it alone. Not only that, but AI, artificial intelligence, has added a whole new dimension to all of this. I saw something on social media yesterday that my mind immediately said, that's impossible. Somebody said, can this really happen? And the first comment was, AI. Sure it can when you incorporate artificial intelligence into it. Did you know that only 8.6% of the things that you worry about are actual legitimate matters of concern? That means that the other 91.2% are either imaginary, will never happen, or involve matters over which you have no control or sway. Oftentimes, the 91.2% of things we get worked up about are the things we saw on screens. And the majority of that is taken out of context or just flat out lies. Our mind is a battleground, and John 8:44 reminds us that Satan is a liar and he wants to corrupt our minds with his lies in whatever means possible. So rather than putting in a little of this and a little of that, allow the Holy Spirit to control your mind with God's truth, Paul says. Look, when Jesus stood before Pilate, and Jesus mentioned the truth, Pilate's response was classic. What is truth? What is truth? 2,000 years ago, what is truth? Because for centuries, Greeks and Romans have been philosophizing, trying to figure out what is truth, and they still haven't figured it out. It's because it's in this book, and they're not looking at the right place. So what is truth? Our world is still confused and trying to figure that one out. Fill your minds with what is true, Paul said. Whatever is noble and right, whatever is honorable, upright, virtuous. It doesn't mean we hide our heads in the sand and avoid anything that's unpleasant or going on in the world around us. It doesn't mean that it does mean rather that we focus our attention on the things that are right rather than the things that are dishonorable. Whenever you find yourself going down paths in your mind that you know are not going to be honoring to God, that are upright or virtuous, bounce your thoughts. Do a U-turn in your mind and begin to focus on something that is honorable, something that is pleasing. One of the things that I do, you know how they say misery loves company? Welcome to my world, company. Whenever this is going on in my mind and I'm trying to bounce that thought, I'm trying to reflect, I'm trying to get away from those things, what I do is I just start singing. I start singing a hymn. I start singing a praise song. I start remembering scripture. I start counting my blessings. I do whatever I can to make that U-turn possible. Because if I don't, I'm going to continue down that road. And it's not a road I enjoy going down in the end. Fill your mind with whatever is noble and right. Paul said, fill it with whatever is pure, lovely, and admirable. Pure for Paul, I'm sure at this point, had a lot to do with sexual immorality. Because they were dealing with it then, just like we're dealing with it today. Lovely means things that are beautiful and attractive. Admirable means worth talking about. There's a whole lot of chatter these days in the news and on social media that is really not worth your time and effort or us talking about. And it definitely isn't lovely. So fill your mind, Paul said, with whatever is excellent and praiseworthy. If it is beneficial, if it's going to motivate others in a positive way to do better, if it has praise, if it's worth sharing with others, then share it. If not, bypass it. As believers, we can't afford to waste brain power on thoughts that tear ourselves or other people down. Heard a statistic this past week. Again, whatever statistics are worth these days. Over 90% of adults say that their online presence contradicts their real life. Wow. Guard your heart and your mind. Don't waste your brain power on that stuff. We need to not just guard our heart and mind, not just fill our heart and mind, but we need to renew our mind. Romans 12:2 reminds us, don't conform to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Transformation is an ongoing process. It's not just a single event. We need to continually fill our minds and to guard our minds, continually fill them with God, focus on the things that that He would have us put in there. I can wake up first thing in the morning and go, okay, I'm determined today to guard my heart and my mind, to focus on the things of God. And by mid-morning, I've got to renew that. By mid-morning, I'm already to a place where I'm like, oh, goodness. And so it's a constant renewal. It's not just a one-moment decision. It's daily and consistent. Because the pattern of this world is evil. The pattern of this world is godless. The pattern of this world is morally corrupt. Paul had good reason to encourage us to renew our minds, and he explains why in the last part of the verse when he said, then we will understand what God wants from us. How many of y'all would like to know God's will for your life? How many would like you like to know what God wants you to do? Well, if you do these things, if you guard your heart and your mind in this way, Paul says, then you'll know. His plan, His will, His purpose for your life. Not just any plan, His good plan and perfect plan. One that leads us towards spiritual and moral growth. His pleasing plan, not necessarily one that pleases us or pleases our friend group, but one that pleases God. And we will know His perfect plan. No improvement necessary. It's the absolute best for our lives. Just like that milkshake with the pure ingredients in it. Just a little, has a huge effect on our hearts and minds. It has a huge effect on what others experience. And so the choice is ours when it comes to what we put in or what we allow in. So Paul says we need to guard what we allow in. Then we need to fill our heart and our mind with good ingredients. And when we do, we discover God's plans and purposes. If we will continually renew our mind, our life will be transformed. Our heart, our attitudes will be changed. And what others will experience is a beautiful mind. Lord, we thank You for this reminder, especially in the day in which we're living. Father, help each one of us to begin to take inventory of what we allow in and those things that we allow to affect our daily living. And then, Lord, help us to desire Your things over those. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have a decision to make of some type this morning, we'd love to celebrate with you in that. I'll be right here at the front, and we'd love to hear about it. It's an opportunity during this song to respond. If you just want to simply respond through continuing to praise and worship God, you can do that too. Let's stand and sing together.
Oh,
guy picture. Jerry and I had a conversation this past week, and I got to hear Jerry's faith journey, and it's been such a beautiful faith journey. He's been
a while now. And he said, you know, Danny, most people don't realize I'm not yet a member. And I said, well, Jerry, you can fix that anytime you want. So he came forward this morning and said he's ready to transfer his letter of membership. Family, how about it? So we rejoice in that. Father God, as we prepare to leave this place, the world's peddling just a little. But Father, you have so much more for us. So Lord, help us to take hold of what you have for us as we leave this place. Now let's sing our benediction.
Let's be the time.